Hello, my name is Michelle Embleton, and in this video, we are going to have a look at what is hydrosalpinx and how can we treat it. Hydrosalpinx is an alteration of the female reproductive system characterized by accumulation of liquid in the fallopian tubes. This then prevents sperm and egg meeting or can prevent implantation of the embryo. Hence, women with this condition often have to turn to assisted reproduction techniques. In this video, we'll have a look at what is hydrosalpinx, what are the causes of hydrosalpinx, how it is diagnosed, how it is treated, how having hydrosalpinx affects your fertility, and then we'll have a look at a couple of the most frequently asked questions and answer them for you. Hydrosalpinx is characterized by a blockage in the fallopian tubes due to liquid accumulating in them. In the female reproductive system, we have two fallopian tubes. So a hydrosalpinx can be either unilateral, where it affects only one of the fallopian tubes, or bilateral, where it affects both of the fallopian tubes. Usually, when hydrosalpinx is present, it is bilateral, so in both of the fallopian tubes. The presence of liquid in the distal part of the fallopian tubes causes the tubes to swell and actually prevents the passage of the sperm and the egg. The liquid inside the fallopian tubes can also affect the implantation of the embryo within a uterus. Therefore, hydrosalpinx is a tubal factor of female sterility, and women with this will often have to resort to assisted reproduction techniques in order to achieve pregnancy. Hydrosalpinx is usually the result of an infection, such as pelvic inflammatory disease. Two of the most common culprits of pelvic inflammatory disease are chlamydia and gonorrhea, but it can be caused by other naturally occurring bacteria within the female reproductive system. A chronic and undiagnosed and untreated case of pelvic inflammatory disease can lead to inflammation of the fallopian tubes called salpingitis. If this is not treated, it can result in the fallopian tubes becoming swollen, distended, and full of fluid, and this is called hydrosalpinx. It can be caused by other things than infection, for example, in endometriosis, which is where uterine tissue grows outside of the uterine cavity. It could be caused by insertion of an intrauterine device for contraceptive purposes. Previous surgeries of the reproductive system could also be a possible cause, as could genital tuberculosis. If you've had a previous ectopic pregnancy, it could also be an indicating factor that hydrosalpinx may be present. All of these things can lead to the presence of scar tissue within the tubes, and as a result, swelling, inflammation, and collection of fluid inside the fallopian tubes. Hydrosalpinx is generally something that women don't notice, as they don't have any pain or discomfort, and is only noticed when the woman has fertility issues and is having trouble getting pregnant. However, sometimes hydrosalpinx does present with symptoms such as pain in the lower belly or fever or vomiting, or indeed an increased amount of foul-smelling vaginal discharge. Some women discover they have hydrosalpinx when they have suffered an ectopic pregnancy. There are various tests which are used to diagnose hydrosalpinx, and one of these would be a transvaginal ultrasound, in which the gynecologist can visualize using ultrasound the swollen fallopian tube. However, this is not always the best diagnostic percent and gives about 15% accuracy. Hysterosalpingography is the most commonly used technique to see if there's an obstruction in the fallopian tubes, in which a special dye is inserted into the female reproductive system and then observed via x-rays to see if there is a blockage in the tubes within the system. Laparoscopy is a more invasive way of looking if there is a hydrosalpinx, as it requires a surgical incision and then using a special camera to visualize the area. However, the advantage of this is if there is a hydrosalpinx present, the surgeon can then perform the corrective procedure at the same time. Obviously, as this is a surgical procedure, anesthesia and a surgical environment is required. The treatment of hydrosalpinx will depend on the cause of the hydrosalpinx. If there is still infection present, your doctor will prescribe antibiotics. Doxycycline is one of the most frequently prescribed antibiotics for a hydrosalpinx. If after antibiotic treatment, the hydrosalpinx is not resolved, the doctor may then resort to a surgical technique in order to remove the part of the fallopian tube which is swollen. One of these is a salpingectomy, in whereby the section of the fallopian tube is surgically removed. An alternative to this is a tubal occlusion, whereby the surgeon uses a special device to block the tube off. The aim of these surgical interventions is to prevent the liquid in the hydrosalpinx from reaching the uterus, as this can affect the chances of embryo implantation in any assisted reproduction techniques. Achieving pregnancy with hydrosalpinx does have its difficulties. A natural pregnancy requires the egg and sperm to meet in the fallopian tube and then the resulting embryo to travel through the tube to the uterus where it implants. If hydrosalpinx is present, the egg and sperm are severely infected in the ability to meet and the implantation of the embryo is also affected. If the hydrosalpinx is bilateral and both tubes are blocked, the woman will have to resort to IVF in order to get pregnant, as this involves the fertilization of the sperm and egg outside of the body, and then the embryos will be transferred into the uterus, thereby avoiding the need for the fallopian tubes. If, however, the hydrosalpinx is unilateral and just on one side, and the other fallopian tube is permeable, an artificial insemination process may be a suitable treatment. In either way, in the case of a hydrosalpinx and an assisted reproduction treatment, it is very important to either remove or seal a tube with a hydrosalpinx in order that the liquid that has accumulated inside the fallopian tube cannot have access to the uterus. This would actually have very negative effects for the embryo itself. Hydrosalpinx affects fertility in two ways. The first is the obstruction of the fallopian tubes, and the second is the actual liquid inside the fallopian tubes can affect the embryo development of the embryo itself. The liquid itself can also provide a mechanical action which prevents the movement of the embryo correctly to the uterus for implantation. This fluid can be toxic to sperm. It can also contain antibodies to several things which can affect the implantation of the embryo. It's been shown that this fluid, this accumulated fluid, can also have a negative effect on the endometrium and block expression of certain genes that are required for embryo implantation to occur. Another important but serious complication is the presence of this liquid, if fertilization occurs, can actually prevent the movement of the developing embryo so that it implants in the fallopian tube, causing an ectopic pregnancy, which will then result in that part of the fallopian tube having to be removed. These are the reasons why it is so important in the case of a hydrosalpinx to correctly treat it and, if necessary, remove the parts of the fallopian tube so that none of the liquid is present and able to access the uterus. Therefore, any future assisted reproduction techniques such as IVF have a much greater chance of success. Now we're going to have a look at some of the most frequently asked questions from our users and answer them for you. Can I get pregnant naturally with hydrosalpinx? The answer to this will depend on if your hydrosalpinx is unilateral or bilateral in both tubes. If the hydrosalpinx is bilateral, it is almost impossible for a natural conception to occur, and you're going to have to resort to assisted reproduction techniques such as IVF in order to get pregnant. If the hydrosalpinx is unilateral and the other fallopian tube is in good working order, then it may be possible to get pregnant naturally. However, you must treat the hydrosalpinx in the other fallopian tube to make sure that the liquid accumulated inside it doesn't affect the chances of fertilization and implantation of any developing embryos. How can I prevent hydrosalpinx? The best way to prevent hydrosalpinx is to prevent any sexually transmitted diseases which can result in pelvic inflammatory disease. So practicing good sexual health practices, using a barrier form of contraception, and not having frequent changing sexual partners. Additionally, if you are diagnosed with an infection within your reproductive tract, getting medical help and assistance quickly and getting treated quickly really helps with any to avoid any future complications. We would like to hear about your experiences, so please do leave us a comment in below. And if you've liked the video and found it informative, don't forget to press like and subscribe so you don't miss any of our future videos. And as always, I'd like to remind you that I leave you in the description below a link to an article where you can read a lot more about this topic in greater detail.